What's up, Moose fam? We are back. This will be our final weekly review for regular season. It's actually kind of sad. I enjoy doing this. It's a lot of work, but I really do enjoy doing it. And again, I know I've said it a million times, but I can't thank you guys enough for tuning in every week and being a part of the discussion and really making this channel what it's grown to be. I told you already that next year is going to be bigger and badder, and I mean it. We now have two of the three letters required to be approved through the CHL for accredited media status. And Scott McIntosh has agreed to write the third letter. I could have went to Baikomo. They said they would write me a letter as well. But I didn't want to do this without the Mooseheads support. So he was more than happy to help me out, and he's going to get that letter to me as soon as possible. But in this video today, we're going to start off by watching the replays. And then we'll get into talking about the last week in the queue for the Moose. And we'll move on to talking about the future of the playoffs and what it's going to mean for the herd. So we're going to watch the playoffs or the recaps now. If you don't want to watch that, join us back in 10 minutes or so. And if you're watching this, post recording or post live, just fast forward about 10 minutes and we should be done with the replays then. Anyways, guys, see you in a few.
Sea Dogs trying to get it out and do, and it's pedal to center. He slides it into Miller. Miller, Halifax zone, back to pedal, scores! And that's the start you want. As Tyler Pedal has been hot of late, and that line has looked awfully good together. So out comes Drew Elliott at center. He's got Shimmick and Mateko on the wings. Now underway, puck is in the neutral zone. Elliott takes it down the wall. He's into the Halifax zone. Elliott up high, throws it, Mateko, score! Now underway, puck is in the neutral zone. Elliott takes it down the wall. He's into the Halifax zone. Elliott up high, throws it, Mateko, scores! Away. Puck at center ice, Shimmick into Halifax territory. Looks, fires it. Milner steers it away. Down the wall, here comes Elliott. Puts it up high to the point, Tivi Cree. Moser gets his pocket pick and back to center ice. It's Miller with Fournier. Slides it up. Here comes Miller. Takes it wide. Goes around the goal. Puts it in front. Scores! Brody lead. It's 3-0. Colin Miller took the puck wide on his backhand. Slid it out in front. And there's Fournier. Right in the right spot to put it past Jack Milner. And the chance. So close. Now puck out to center ice and man levels Reynolds. Here comes Pedal. Shot. Scores! Dogs have built a 4-0 lead. What a shot by Tyler Pedal. He is playing. Well, you're just so happy for the guy. Coming over from Drummondville. Columbus Blue Jacket up with it. Pedal. Turns it, cycles it in behind the net to Fournier. Fournier into the near corner. Fournier up the boards, he comes. Shot on goal, and Rousseau. Phillips, straight up ice. To his own blue line. On to Kilfoyle. High slot, shot scores. What a shot. Kilfoyle, the Quispam Sys native, he had time. High slot, pulled it back, and he snapped it over the blocker's shoulder of Patrick Lever. Lever looked surprised with the location of the shot, how quickly he got it away. And keeps it in. Ionello looks, shot, save, rebound! It's still in there! Rousseau down, around the back of the goal, it's out in front, pedal shot! Oh, Rousseau knocks it out of the air with a glove! The draw, one back to the point, Tivi can't keep it in, now a foot race. Blasting through, that's Vinicek. Vinicek scores. By Marcus Vinicek. He just steamed through the middle and then slid it underneath Patrick Lever. The Sea Dogs lead now is 4-2. 7-3 plays it around. Denis, he's bodied by Beveridge. 11 seconds left in the period. Schultz down the wall. Shot into the midsection of Lever with a nice job by McLean, tying up his man in front, and then down to the ice goes Denis at the center ice to Shimmick. He'll flip it high in the air. It's going to bounce one hop right to Rousseau. They score! Drew Elliott! His 17th goal of the season. It doesn't get any bigger than that. On the one hop bounce, Elliott bangs it home. The Sea Dogs lead is now 5-2. He doesn't want to do anything other than eat the clock, and that's what he's going to do. 6 seconds. They pile in, but there's not going to be any play, and the fans stand to their feet. 2.6 seconds left. They stop it. But it is going to be, that's the hockey game. The referee says, we're done.
De joueurs sur la patinoire à 7 minutes 18 secondes.
He's around the back of the goal. Following up is Pedal. Pedal puts it towards the front of the net. Amiot at the blue line, throws it towards the goal, bounces, still in there, scores! Pedal, Pedal! The hockey game. Woo! That is a huge goal for St. John, and Tyler Pedal has been outstanding over this home stretch. The left of Patrick Lever. It'll be Drew against Todd. Now the shot, that's off the crossbar. And Beaulieu will get to it. Gets it over to Denis, around the back of the goal. Throws it up high. McKinnon looks, shot, that's blocked by Miller. He's down, another shot, they score. And fired it through a maze of bodies. And the Halifax Mooseheads have regained their lead. It's 2-1. That'll be McKinnon's third goal of the season.
Drew Elliott. Une aide au numéro 10, Joe Agnello, à 21 secondes.
Off by Pedal. He banks it off the boards at the line, still in there, and then out the center. It's a 2-on-1 with Pedal and Fournier. Pedal, high slot, shot, the save made by Rousseau, and he will smother it and hold with 20 behind the Sea Dog goal. Ionello past the center ice. Here comes Beveridge into the high slot, cross ice pass. That's Elliott, shot, save, rebound, and it's gathered in by Martin, and he will now to center ice. Martin off the boards, in behind the St. John goal. It bounces out in front, and Ionello clears. At the line, a shot, they score! A rocket shot from the point. That's McKinnon's second goal. And looking it over for a second look to make sure you get the right call. It's no goal. Well, what now? Jim Midgley says, I need to talk to somebody, the head coach for the Mooseheads. What is that all about? Hi, Iannello. Pedal on the half wall. Up to Iannello. Iannello walks the blue line. Cross ice. Schimmick scores! Beautiful pass right in the wheelhouse, and Schimmick loaded up and pulled the trigger. Schimmick, his 19th of the season, and the Sea Dogs lead 4-2. Of course, they're doing the video review. Let's not get too excited. And we'll see what the referee, does he point or wave his arms as in no goal? And quite a conversation at the timekeeper's bench. No goal. So now to the point. Schultz will keep it in. Schultz. His cross ice pass to Vitacek. Vitacek turns back. Cross ice scores. What a blast from Jan Spreiner. Power play goals here this afternoon. And you don't want to give them any more opportunities with the man advantage. That one-timer off the stick of Jan Spreiner. He's bodied, throws it through, back to the point. Up high to Martin, shot, the save is made, they score! Jack Martin, his third of the season. They'll review it, but Lever looked like he got a piece of it in the blocker's side, and then it squeaked through. Mooseheads lead, and the Ramparts lose. The Sea Dogs are in. If the Ramparts only come up with 1 point, the Sea Dogs are in. Play underway, they score. Off the faceoff. I think that's Vitacek. 5:27 remaining. Off the faceoff. Vitacek just walks it, improves his shooting angle, and snaps it over the glove shoulder of Patrick Lever. And tie this hockey game if they want to put their mark on a playoff hope. Shot from the point, the redirect, they score again. Oh, the roof is caved. And that puck going back to the point, Jack Martin fires it through, and it's a high tip. Once again, over the shoulder of Patrick Lever, glove side, behind the net. He goes up the boards, the pedal over to Miller. Miller's shot, that's in front, bounces around, still in there, loose puck, scores! Brody Fournier! Something to cheer about. That lead has been cut to 2. With 2 minutes and 40 seconds left, it's likely Patrick Lever will go back into the goal, as it was just the way I scripted it. Get the puck to the front. That draw is won back into the corner. It bounces to the line at center. Here comes the shot. That's the hockey game. 2 seconds. Elliott pours the goal off the side of the net. That's the hockey game. And the St. John Sea Dogs.
All right. So that was the 2 games. We only had 2 games this week. Let's, I guess, get right into it. I got to pull up my chat here, guys. Sorry, give me a second. I haven't even been looking at my chat. I'm sorry. If there is any. There's a couple. Hey, hon. What up, Lindsay? I think another on these recaps need to do their math. They said McKinnon's second goal. It was his third. Oh, I heard third. Maybe I'm wrong. All right. Steve's going to join in here in a minute. Dylan's going to skip the portion where we talk about the last 2 games because, of course, he didn't watch them. He, lucky bastard, was down in Vegas visiting Dom and the Las Vegas Golden Knights. He was actually there for a work conference, but he had a great time down there. Waiting for his audio. Waiting for Steve's audio. Oh, we got 21 people in the lobby. That's awesome. Hey, everybody. What up, Steve? How you doing, bud? Oh. Steve's experiencing technical difficulties. All right. So I'm going to get right into it. I have a couple things I want to talk about the first game. I got to say, that first game was extremely, extremely disappointing. Not because we lost. And I think it has a lot to do with the call-ups, the defense. We were very thin on the defensive line. We were playing our veteran defense too many minutes, and you know, the kids that we called up, George and Doyle, they're just too inexperienced. They got walked on, they got left behind, they got their ankles broke. You know, they're just not ready to compete at this level, and I think they were killing us that entire first game. What do you think, Steve?
I'm turning on the other phone there. I just arrived late, eating and all stuff. I was duty too, so it was kind of late. But yeah, duty. What is the fun of duty? So I know I can talk about the second game, the first game. Lose track a little bit. I believe it was almost the same score, 7 goals for St. John's there. And they couldn't catch up.
No, the first game was 5-2.
The first game? 5-2.
Yeah.
Yes, 5-2. Yeah. The second game was 7-4. Yeah.
Hang on one second. Yeah, Trevor, we are going to want to hear about the bus trip after we get past these two games. That's what I want to talk about next. So I would love to see you guys fill up the chat with all things bus related so I can read it for everybody else who wasn't on the bus trip. I know you guys had an amazing time, and I heard you guys put on a good trip, so right after we get out these reviews, we'll jump right into that because I want to hear about it. Sorry, go ahead.
So basically, the two was on 1.22, and it went back to St. John's ball court afterwards. It was ours. It was St. John's. There they press a lot. So what I seen from the beginning of the game until near the end, they tried to get back in there, and the empty goal just give them less hope there. But I mean,
are we still talking about the first game?
Yeah, the first game.
Did we have an empty net?
They had an empty net. We got an empty net on the second game.
So they got an. Oh, I see. There. Sorry, it's hard for me to follow sometimes. So I see what you're saying. When we pulled our goalie, we tried, but we just couldn't make it work. Is what you're saying?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. So
and, you know, it's something that they need. They practice, and it fell on this one. But you know what? It's good to practice those situations, so in the playoff we don't get the strangle. And I think the coaches probably get some cue on this, and they'll probably adjust when we need a goal ASAP with an empty netter. That's another situation that's great. For me, it's unfortunate to get that goal from St. John, but so you know what? It's part of the game. It's the end.
I got to disagree with you. I don't think the plays were the problem. I don't think that our readiness or our stick-to-itiveness was the problem. I think the problem with the first game is that we were playing the last three games our veteran defenseman, where we're getting 35 minutes a game. You know, I think the fact that we had two call-ups, that it was their first high-pressure game in the QMJHL, was the problem. If you look at the first two goals in that game, George got skated by. He just couldn't keep up. That's what killed us that game. I mean, if we're going to be honest, no, and nothing bad about them. Next year, the year after, they're going to be great kids. They're going to be great for the organization. But they weren't ready this game, and I get why we had them up. It's because, you know, Furlong was down. Morvek was out. We had some people that were sitting out because of injuries or sick. So I get it, but I don't think there's anything we could have done differently as a team to win that game. I just don't see it.
And of course, Brody Fernier was a superstar in that game,
he
and he
was.
did the same thing in the second game.
He did.
But I will talk about the first game. So, yeah, he had the golden assist there, like beautiful for them. Good on him. And you know what? It's when you're a moosehead once, you're always a moosehead, and doesn't matter. That's a constant thing for any players that goes as a moosehead. They always wear at least something for the moosehead. Like Nathan MacKinnon and Jonathan Drouin, Nico Hischier, some Timo Meier, all those guys that plays in the NHL, they always have a piece of a moosehead either on them or on their heart there. So, I mean, Brody Fernier is giving it all this year, and he gave a lot more points in his time with the St. John's than with us. But unfortunately, like he had the chance to do it.
I think if we would have kept him, he would have been the same player for us. I think the
definitely.
Kid was, he was on a hot streak when we got rid of him, and I get why we did. Was it the right trade?
No.
We will never know. Some people say yes, some people say no. Dylan, I don't mean that it was a high stakes or high pressure game as a whole, but for these boys, you know, coming in the end of a season when you know, St. John's looking to get into the playoffs, and it was a high pressure game. 100%.
It may not
have been for the Mooseheads, but for the Sea Dogs, it definitely was a high pressure game. So
that's what it meant a lot for them, like you say, the high pressure.
Yeah.
And that would be the same thing. The bottom team that could beat the first team to get in the playoff, and that's basically what happened.
Yeah.
And you know, the Moosehead will take their chances, and that's what happened in the second game. That's they take their chances. Mooseheads took their chances and do it.
No.
And on the first game, well, that's what there, and they knew Quebec was fast and furious to get that last spot. And unfortunately, they didn't make it this year. It sucks for them, and their fans. They're disappointed with 12,000 fans on that same night that the Mooseheads won on the second game.
It
but,
is what it is.
You know,
man.
It is what it is.
So I gotta tip my hat to Midgley.
Yeah,
I know, right? I gotta tip my hat to him. During that first game and the second game, but we'll talk about that later. The first game in the second period, Rooster started, so he took over for Milner. Milner let four in first period. Just wasn't Milner's night. He's got some stuff to work on. I don't know if it's mental or what it is, but you know, he's shown us he's a good goalie. He's just got to get back into it. But not only did he, you know, he had the balls to pull the goalie, he also switched the lines up and made it a lot more, I don't even know the
a diverse
just,
one.
It's
a diverse lines.
It just gelled better. The second period, they seemed like they were working
hard. Yeah, they caught
like
up.
Yeah,
they caught up.
You know, so shout out to Mitchley. He did his job in game one. And he did exactly what a coach should do. Did you see Rooster save? I think it was a power play for them. It's a PK for us. He went down. He was down and out. He was beat. The whole net was open, and he reaches up a glove, and stops the puck.
Was that the glove, and he went down.
Oh
yeah.
My God, that was beautiful.
But that. That's a Brewster save anyway.
That's
so
crazy.
That's what he does every time. And, that's how athleticism player do, and lots of respect what he's doing. Even Milner is doing a few those saves, but that game is just unfortunate with
not
the
his game.
Young defenseman.
Yeah,
right.
Not
so,
his game. Yeah. I think that save is gonna be on TSN. At the very least, it should be number one in the QMJHL Plays of the Week. That was a beautiful save. He was down and out, and he saved it.
He did lots of those during the season, but that one will beat one of them, so definitely.
Jared, we're not talking about that. I said on my last live we were going to discuss it once, and we're not going to discuss it again. That's his business, not ours. As long as he gets on the ice for us and plays second game of the playoffs. That's all I care about.
There was in that game, that first game, it was a commemorative for Mr. Reynolds.
It was a what, sorry?
So, an honorable 20-year-old for Reynolds by the Sea Dogs. What a classic move. Like, when I seen that, he's got the jersey of Sea Dogs and everything, number 7.
Yeah, it makes me wonder why we didn't. It makes me wonder why we didn't do that for Fournier. Fournier did get a jersey after one of the games. I seen him with it, but we didn't. Didn't do anything for him, which I kind of sucks. But I mean, I guess you can't do everything for everybody. You know, there's game to play and stuff. I get it, but it was nice to see the Sea Dogs honor Reynolds. He was with them for 4 years. Who else was there? Do you know who else was there? Sorry if I'm sniffling a lot. I'm still kind of sick.
Who else was there?
Who else was honored?
Honored that night?
That night.
On the first game?
Yeah.
I don't remember that. You gotta refresh my mind.
Josh Lawrence.
Oh, yeah.
They had him out on the ice, yeah.
I got his jersey as can't say jersey, the one nice. With the purple one. So yeah. I got his jersey. So
he's a cool guy.
He's a big boy.
You know,
he's doing good.
He's doing really good. And you know what, man? When he was here, I thought he was a bit of a jerk because he would never talk to fans. He was just really, you know, focus driven. But the kid he sent over, I reached out to him and I said, you know, there's a kid here who really likes you. I don't know this kid personally, but his mother reached out to me. And I said, you know, he really wants a puck from you for Christmas. Josh, with 2 weeks left to Christmas, Josh, the next day must have sent it out because he got here, you know, 4 days before Christmas. You know, he's a good kid, man. He's a real good kid.
And he's got a work ethic really phenomenal. And with the Moosehead, he quite get lots of points. And
yeah.
Like, he's...
Sorry,
he's a two-way player.
I apologize. Not honored, yep. But I mean, he was brought out onto the ice. They announced him there. You know, he didn't get any certificate or anything like that. You guys take everything so literal. My God. So what else do we have from that? I think that's it from that. I do want to discuss, you know, one kid that's progressively getting better this season is Kilfoyle. And I got to tell you, I wasn't his biggest fan when he first started. He seemed a little shy and timid and didn't want to get mixed up with anything. He would dump and chase. But I talked about it on a live recently where, you know, he's starting to work harder, be more aggressive. And that little snipe, that quick release on, was it on Friday night? Completely confused their goalie over their block. It was just a beautiful shot. Did you see that one?
That one, I didn't see it. Probably missed it, of course. The Moosehead plays 45 minutes. Well, basically, like, that's basically what I did on that Friday night. I was, it's just because I was duty that night.
Duty.
So, you said yeah, duty. That was, yeah, I'm duty a lot. So, I'm overnight, and I was just here in peace, and I had to do a few things, rounds and stuff. It was a little bit movement, so I missed half the game. But yes, I totally agree. Kilford got a little bit better and better,
yeah.
Like every time that he was on the ice. And I seen it on the second game. Totally, he's fast and furious, and he work, and get a good player with him, and it's got to be good to go, right?
Yeah.
He was doing good chemistry with Lou, so.
No, I agree. I think those two kids are going to be absolutely incredible for us for in the future. Looked out, please, on the top line. Kilfoyle has not looked out of place on the top line. I think he did look out of place on the top line. I think he's much better where he is, personally. So let's get into game two. I only have a couple notes to game two. We won. So it's hard to comment too much about game two when we beat them 7-4. I will say, however, that I think Rooster in both games, I think our goalies were tested way too often. Our defense really needs to button up because it's not impressive right now. But the CHL really shit the bed on that game. We couldn't hear anything. You know, I'd say out of 60 minutes, we may have heard 30 minutes of play at the most, half the game. At the most.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, we didn't hear anything.
I heard 100% on our end.
You were there. We heard you guys the first game, we heard you guys. But we didn't hear you in the second game because we couldn't.
Because of the sound.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they knew they put a microphone right by the bench. And yeah, like there's a couple of things that in that game, I was just behind Midgley. And I said to the boys, shoot him on his blocker. That's where he's weak right now. We leave her. Shoot it there. Don't shoot at his glove. You see all those saves on the 20-year-old display there? And that's exactly what I told him. I was like, Midgley. And at one point, I was telling the score of the Quebec. And I don't know if he nudged or something, but he probably acknowledged it. Like, they want to get focused in the game, right?
Yeah.
But little things to just tell the coach and the players. And like, hey, you should. And as soon as they broke the ice, I seen Vivacek go right on his glove. I was like, there you go. You broke his confidence and bang. Like, that was a beautiful shot from Vivi. Like, the top corner he delivered, I was like, that's what we expect from the top player.
Yeah.
Like, to get and break the goalie first, and after play your finest shots you can do. And I think that will help a lot for the playoff.
Yeah. Let me ask you something, Steve, and everybody in the chat. Yep. I have a hockey question for you. You guys, a lot of you guys seem to be a lot more knowledgeable than me, so I'm going to defer to you.
It's an eraser.
But if a shot is coming to the net and a player gets a high stick to the face prior to the puck going in the net, is it a goal? Or should it be blown dead?
I would say it's still a goal.
Still a goal. Even though there was a high stick before the goal?
Yep. Unless you mean the high stick, like
hit somebody in the face. Yeah.
It's a goal. Still a goal.
Still a goal. Even if the penalty happened before the goal, it's still a goal?
Yeah. I can recall one the NHL goal. If people in the chat remember Michael Pezzetta with Montreal Canadiens. We'll talk a little bit of Montreal Canadiens because he's got his first goal from his face and got in and got accepted as a goal because he was in the motion. It's like a kicking motion. If you're going like this, like head, it wouldn't be acceptable. But if they slap it and it went right in the face and go in, It's still a goal. It's a non-intentional goal. And you've seen a lot of players because I think, I remember, there was one of the goals in that game. And I know where you're getting that because that was one of the goals that I think St. John did.
Yeah, and Phillips got a high stick to the face.
Yep.
So hold on, Dylan. I think the thing is they had possession of the puck, and the people in front of the net were rallying for a spot in front of the net, and that's when the high stick happened, and then the shot was taken, and you know what I mean. So they did have possession of the puck, but whatever, it is what it is. I personally thought that it should have been blown dead upon contact with Phillips' face, but. It is what it is.
I think they reviewed that one.
They didn't review that one. Oh, no, they did. No, I think they did review that one. Yeah. Yeah.
They thought it was a goalie interference, but it was not. And they were just making sure who had the goal. And I believe it was, Drew Elliott scored in numbers 47.
I don't know how much more professional I can be. I'm not vaping on here. I love kids. If you don't want to watch, don't watch.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm sorry. That just really pissed me off. So I didn't think I didn't think the actual officiating was too good. Me and Dylan talked about
it was Melanson, by the way. Was reffing this.
Melanson.
As London, yeah. It was with a stash and all stuff. I was like,
yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. it's just the fact that, you know, the goal that was taken away from us would have been McKinnon's second of the night. Yep. They called it goaltender interference, but it looked like the goaltender left his crease to chase after Cattleford. Am I correct in saying
that? Yes. Yeah, it was before, because as soon as he went in right in front, he got like the glove ungloved onto it and touched his glove a little bit, and afterwards he went when he went forward, he kind of, you know, when you got magnets, it was totally magnets, and it dragged him. He dragged him at the same time there, and they called that an interference. It's a gray area, because personally, if it was that interference, it would have been called. I call that it's not a right, because he was out of those crease. But the one previous that probably that's where they called the interference. I would have to ask Mitchley about this or anybody.
Well, Mitchley wasn't happy. He called the ref over. He's like, "You're gonna have to explain this to me."
Yeah.
Yeah, that exactly. Was absolutely ridiculous.
I didn't hear what he was saying behind the bench there. I couldn't hear really, like it was quite loud too. And of course, Tyler beside me was fairly rattly. He was like saying, "Go, Moose, go. It's the goal. It's a goal." So it was kind of hard to.
No, you're wrong. So I had to with that. You're wrong, Dylan. The goalie left the crease and started attacking Cataford, as did the defender.
Kind of dragged him at the same time.
Yeah, it was. I don't know. Regardless, we can dispute it all day, but we won the game. No, it is what it is. Can I just ask everybody a favor? If there's any critiques on the show, I love hearing you guys' critique. I really do, in a polite manner. Can you wait till after the show, please and thank you? I do appreciate all you guys' criticisms. I do take it to heart. But let's wait till after the show so I can get through what I need to say.
And also the game number two there, I think they say it's only Dylan's McKinnon second goal, but it was his third goal.
I heard third. You guys heard second?
I heard second, and I was like, and even Lindsay was like second. I thought it was third because when he scored, I was so happy, and I was like W number 3-3, right? So anyway. That's what I thought for sure. It was this third goal, and I was like looking at the score there. Yes, it is his third goal, and I'm really happy for him. He scores more than the years before, so it's good. It's amazing. I love it, and he keeps the energy up.
Dylan heard third as well. I think you guys misheard because Dylan heard third as well. Regardless, it was his third goal. He would have had his fourth though.
I know. Get this out. It's like, what the fuck? God.
what the fudge? Going after the game, it was heartwarming. Brody Fournier, you know, hugging all the boys. And, you know, it was cool, man. It was really cool to see. And, you know, the fact that all of you guys there were screaming for him. And, you know, he gave you guys a salute. He's a class act, man. I absolutely love that kid. Absolute class act. You know what I mean? Yes, buddy. Yes, buddy. Reynolds honored. We already talked about that. The new Moose Tracks video is out. I like it. I love the Moose Tracks video. This year it's been absolutely incredible. By the way, is today Tuesday?
We are Tuesday tacos.
Tomorrow you'll hear more about the Moose Track videos, as we had Scott McIntosh on last week, and his interview is coming out tomorrow morning. So he touches on that a little bit, and he discusses a lot of stuff. Actually, it was a really nice interview. A little bit of a funny clip in the beginning. So make sure you guys tune into that tomorrow. It was good. But what did you think of the Moose Tracks? Did you watch it?
I've been honest. I was really busy with work, but I'll definitely go and watch it. I was not prepared at all. Like, it was really rushed today. And the kids are crazy a little bit. But
they're always
good.
Crazy, but I love them.
We loved them. I'm going to just check it out very quick. It started with the trip. was it the batter's strip, that one, on the, and that the follow-up, or?
Pardon?
It was the on the moose track.
It started on our last, after we beat Moncton. Okay. And then we went on the road for another three games. So it was like, it was basically a four-game road trip. Because we left right from Moncton to go to Quebec. And then they came back home, too. So afterwards, I think our next game home was the Eagles. And it was really cool. CJ was in the video, blowing his horn.
Oh, look at that. So, yeah, famous. He was happy. Like his dad.
Yeah, well, I was right beside him, but you really couldn't see me too much. But him with his big puffy cheeks blowing on the horn, it was really cool, actually.
That's good.
Let's get to some of the comments. I haven't read much here. So Trevor, you should join the chat to discuss the trip. Yeah, Trevor. Tom Bulger. St. John wanted that game more than we did. 100% the first game. Simple as that. Also didn't help the call ups. Agreed. Sea Dogs have been playing playoff hockey. And Dylan said that. Dylan said before these games started. I'm sorry, my voice is going. Dylan said before the game started this was going to be like playoff hockey. I didn't agree with him. I thought that we would go out there and roast them. But yeah, he already did say that.
We should have won both games for this matter. But unfortunately, they say we get new guys in the lineup.
Like Dylan said, they wanted it more, right?
Yep,
exactly. At least we helped St. John knock Quebec out of the playoffs. True. Trying to help St. John get in the playoffs.
There's Dylan.
What up, Dylan?
We should have won.
Just going through some comments here. Party ceremony. A lot
How
of
you doing,
just
Dylan?
Talking about stuff that we good already yourself? Talked about.
Yeah, good. How was your trip in Vegas?
It was wicked.
Awesome.
Yeah, why don't you tell us a bit about it while I'm reading these to see if there's anything I need to that we haven't talked about yet.
Well, if I start talking and you try to start reading, you're going to just get confused.
I'm reading to myself. You go ahead, bud.
Yeah. What's your best experience in Vegas for the game there?
Oh. One thing I never thought I'd get to do is stand on the bench of an NHL game. Like after the game in the building. That was pretty wicked, waiting for Dom to come out and chatted with him for about a half hour. The atmosphere in that building is absolutely insane.
Did you take a selfie with Dominic?
I didn't get a selfie, but I got pictures with him. Actually, if you want to see some of the pictures, it's in a video that Colin put up on the channel.
Nice. I'll go see it.
And Ducharme might have a little message for the Moose fans in it too.
Oh, yeah. Nice. I'll have a look at it, and I'll probably share it on Facebook so everybody have a look and have a great fun to watch it. And there's one question I wanted to ask you. Did you ever touch one slot machine down there at the arena?
Not in the arena, but I did at the Luxor Hotel.
Okay. I would have thought you would have tried just a $5 going in there, American. Try at least and say, hey, I did it.
No. I did at one of the casinos, but not at the building.
So, yeah it was...
okay, that's good.
It was absolutely awesome seeing Benji's point of view. In the Moose Tracks, John says, and I agree. I really like to listen to him talk. He does not sound like he looks, though. Like he the voice does not match the face. And Melissa says she is so jealous that you got to see Chris Angel.
That was a really good show.
I would imagine.
So one
David
thing that
Copperfield
I got
was always my David Copperfield was always my favorite, but Chris Angel was kind of phenomenal.
Yeah. So one thing that I got while I was down there. They sell the replica Stanley Cup rings.
Oh, yeah.
So I was able to purchase that. And usually when you get, like, the replica Stanley Cup rings, they don't, like, fit at all. But this one actually fits if I wanted to wear it.
Is your memorable cup from the Moose that fit on your hand?
Yeah, I got it right here, actually.
Oh, I don't know if Colin knows about it, but we receive all season ticket holder Memorial Cup ring.
I got one.
He has one.
Oh, you got one?
Yeah, Dylan had two, and he
yes, that one does fit on my hand too.
Yeah,
awesome.
John Seitman says agree 100%. Dylan, I've talked to with their DJ Joe Green, and he's taught me a lot of stuff with adding to my style over here. I'd say he's one of the best in the game, in-game DJs in the NHL.
I would agree. I would, however, say there were points where, to me, the music was too loud. It was too bass heavy.
You're not one of them now, are you?
No, this was legitimately like too bass heavy to the point everything was actually physically shaking.
Try to go to Columbus every time they shoot the cannon.
Yeah, but see, that's different. That's only on goals. On my Facebook, I got about an 8-minute video of them when they're getting ready to come out. Then there's about another 6-minute video that's during intermission that you couldn't even hear the person sitting next to you talking. Like, it was that loud, and the seats were shaking. So, like, crazy atmosphere, but it wasn't the whole time, but there were points where it was just a little too bass heavy.
That's right. And Kim gave CJ one of the rings as well. Melissa just mentioned.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Did Dylan talk about Catterford be ready to maybe go with the Vegas training?
Nothing that I heard, but there are fans there that are really interested to see him because, well, I was wearing the Catterford jersey there. Yeah. So I was stopped quite a few times because of the name on the back. I even had people stop me because of the Moosehead logo on the front and knowing the team.
I'm actually going to bring a comment up that I got on that video, which I thought was really cool. Because
something else that I picked up there is I got one of the warm-up pucks.
Yeah.
I try to collect them at every game that I go to.
So I'm about to switch this over so nobody's going to see you or hear you guys. Just give me a second. So if you guys look right here, this is the video that I made for Dylan on our Facebook page or our YouTube page. Right here, somebody from, I would assume, Vegas said, "I saw you walking around the arena. Hope you had a good time." I thought that was kind of cool that somebody all the way down in Vegas seen our YouTube and then mention the fact that he actually seen you in Vegas walking around the building. I thought that was so cool. To me, that's
nice.
That's so cool, man.
I'm watching it on here on my phone there, and yeah, that's pretty cool. I got two technologies going on there.
You got stopped. You got stopped how many times?
One person right at the end of the row. As soon as I got up the first time, I'd probably say I got stopped about 6 or 7 times.
Due to the jersey.
Because of the jersey, yeah.
Yeah.
Your jersey is BND1, so
now that's people knowing. That's people that know the team. That's not people asking. I've had a few people ask me like, "What jersey is that?" But
okay,
about 6 or 7 times of people that actually know the team. Or or because of the name on the back that no Catterford because they follow the Knights.
Yeah. Which is awesome. That's amazing, man. That was a great choice to wear for that jersey.
But another thing that they do, it's really cool at the start, they have a stage set up outside of their building. And they brought a kid up on the stage. And I'm pretty sure they do this, they have somebody up there every game. And it's probably most likely a kid, but they had them up there and they had the microphone. They're like, "All right, who's ready to go?" And well, everybody there goes crazy. And they're like, "All right, so-and-so, let's get this started." And then the kid says, "Open the fortress." And the horns and sirens go off outside of the building. The very top of the building where it's a big LED screen, it says the fortress is now open. And it's just wicked from the moment that before the door is open.
Rock, they get a full Rockies 100%.
Rocks is greater than Roxy's 100%. Okay.
What does that mean?
I don't know. Rocks greater than Roxy's 100%.
LFG. Okay. That's the LFG crew rolling in, confusing the crowd, I guess.
Are you talking about the Roxbury's is better than Rockies?
Okay, so now it's out of subject there.
All right, so
another subject. Another subject. One of the Q player there, James Malerstra from Quebec last year. He's playing his first NHL game with the Columbus Blue Jacket there. So congratulations for another Q player and making the jump on the NHL. So just letting you know. So it's always great to see kids from the Q goes and jump in the NHL team and get their first game. Like, what a feeling. Like, I mean, it's like the guys are going as a rookie, going to Moosehead, first game, they go through their round and they get their first NHL QMG goal and all stuff. Like, this is a good experience for them that they live in the junior and after they live in the NHL. Like, wow. Like, what are you guys thinking about this? Like, this is huge for young players, especially James, because he won the Prison Cup and the Memorial Cup last year. Like, he was like phenomenal, right? It's great for players like that.
Oh, agreed.
So, speaking of that, one thing that I found really cool was on the Vegas Golden Knights, and there's Ivan Barbashev and William Carrier, who are both through the queue. Barbashev with Moncton and Carrier with the Eagles.
Yeah, and Eagles, and I think he switched for PEI to one point. Yeah,
like, but it was like, it was just cool to see them play again, because I watched them play when they were here. So that was really cool to see that.
Oh yeah,
oh, thank you.
And the X players.
Not to mention Jack Eichel, who was a first overall pick for the Mooseheads. He just decided to go with the NCAA route.
My beautiful wife must have known I needed a drink.
There you go. Awesome.
Oh, that's good. I feel better.
Yeah, it would have been interesting to see Jack Eichel as a Moosehead. It would have been really interesting. Considering after that, he went through a lot. He went a superstar with the Buffalo Sabres, and after just went to Vegas, and they fixed up his back, and he's flying. He's flying.
Although,
that's good.
I think if we did have Eichel at that time, I don't think we would have had Drouin.
That might be a true thing. Yeah.
So
definitely.
We got some one last piece of Moosehead news before we move on to playoffs predictions, who's facing who. Braden McPhee got an award. He got
another one.
That's right. the Jarvis Munger recipient was Braden McPhee this week. Every team in the queue has one player that's awarded this award. And
that's the season, not just the week, I believe.
Yeah, throughout the whole
season.
The
week of the season.
The whole season.
Yeah, but he was awarded for this week.
He was awarded for this week. This week. This week he was awarded. This week.
Yeah, but you said
it
for
wasn't last
this
month,
week. As in
it
like...
wasn't next week. This week. He was awarded.
No, but it was, you said for this week instead of for the season.
Semantics.
Because he...
Semantics. Every year, a player from every team gets awarded this, and this is for scholastic excellence. He also gets a $500
scholarship.
Thank you, sir. So that's cool. I love that they do that. That's awesome. So he's our brainiac.
With that $500 scholarship, he can get one book.
One book. But it's the thought, man. I they're rewarding him for being a good student. I absolutely love that, man. All right, boys. Oh, putting the notes away. Let's talk playoffs. I'm going to go through the West real quick. The West. Is that a misprint?
Yes, it is.
It is.
Okay. Yeah, it is.
So I'm going to go
it
the is. East
the West
first.
East.
I'm going to go through the East first. And so it's Bay Como versus the Islanders. It is Halifax versus the Titan. Moncton versus...
Don't worry about
Sagan. How do you say the damn word?
I can't. I don't even know what you're saying. I couldn't hear what you were saying.
Saguenuins?
Oh, Chicoutimi.
Yeah, but how do you say that?
Chicoutimi? Chicoutimi. Chicoutimi. That's French.
Damn it, Frenchie. I'm talking about the damn name of the team, not the place. The Sag. You can't even say it. You can't even say it. You're French.
Yes, the Saguenay.
You French people just want to make things difficult for people. Then we got the Eagles and the Oceanics. Okay, so that finishes up the East. And on the West, we have the Voltigeurs against the Sea Dogs, the Huskies versus Gatineau Olympique. We have Victoria against Cataracts. We have the Phoenix against Armada. So, me and Dylan were talking about this last night on the drive back from the airport. And we were kind of talking about if this person wins, this person, and it's going to be pretty hard for us to meet up with Moncton in the second round. It looks like it may not happen. Am I correct?
So in order for that to happen, us, Moncton, and Baikomo all have to win, which Baikomo is now missing a big piece of their roster for the rest of the season.
Yep, the defenseman.
So with losing Lamoureux for the defenseman, that's going to be... It's not going to be easy for them to win. I don't think they're going to walk over them as much as they thought they were going to.
I'm just trying to figure out just to have a picture of it. Is that the word? A picture of the playoff there. That's why I'm searching right now. Don't worry about me.
Now, Dylan, you did say there is a world where we face Baikomo second round, right? Or no, third round. Second round.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, we can play Baikomo in the third round. Because if all four of the top teams in the league make it to the semifinals, it gets reseeded at that point to the entire league, which would make it one versus four and two versus three if the top four make it. So it would be Baikomo versus us, and it would be Drummondville versus the Huskies.
Trevor said that Drummondville is the guy, is the team that's missing that guy. He plays for Drummondville.
Oh, it's not Lamoureux?
No. But they
Lamoureux. Lamoureux. Yeah, he's Baikomo.
Yeah. But Baikomo,
that's what I meant.
Well, yeah.
Drummondville. He is Drummondville.
Yeah, yes. But they are missing their big defense guy. I can't remember his name, but I remember
it was Drummondville. No, Drummondville is.
It wasn't Baikomo?
No, it's Drummondville. It's Lamoureux.
So Baikomo's not missing somebody to injury that happened just before?
No, they lost their player to the cancer treatment.
Oh, yes. Yes,
earlier in the season.
Yeah.
Well, there you go. Much better.
That's what
So Drummond. So St. John can actually upset
Drummondville. You think that could happen, though?
Yes.
Really?
I think with the momentum they play against the Moosehead, I think Lever will push 110%. And if Drummondville play their cards right, they can probably crack him just one shot, one goal. And it's not going to be like multiple goal and like all broke down. It's just the one goal. And I think if they get him on a one-time round power play on his glove, that's gonna lose his confidence. But if he's the top of his game and he's focused, not only his glove shot, I think he can probably pull it off and win in the probably 4-3. I would say game seven.
Yeah,
they can pull a 4-3 win.
So
I believe in that.
Jose, Moncton is actually extremely worried about Chicoutimi. From what I understand, anyway, they didn't want them. They didn't want they didn't want the Eagles, and they didn't want Chicoutimi. They would have taken Titans and Eagles is the two that they wanted to play.
We'll see. We'll see if Killer's gonna do anything against Chicoutimi. So we'll see if they're gonna shut down him and the rest of the strong D there. So we'll see. We'll see.
So predictions: Drummondville versus Islanders. Or sorry, Baikomo versus Islanders.
It's gonna be 4-2, Baikomo.
I think it's going to be a sweep, Bakemo.
Yeah.
Yeah, I say sweep, Bakemo.
Yeah. The most the most important one, Halifax C10.
Let's save that one for the end.
All right, let's do that. We'll do that.
Longest one.
Let's do Moncton and Chicoutimi.
Trevor, because this leads right onto it. It was Moncton fans that were saying who they wanted to play.
Yeah, it was Moncton's fans. 4-0 Bakemo in that one, John says.
Also, Moncton versus Chicoutimi is a 2-3-2 series.
Yeah.
So it's not the 2-2-1-1-1. Which
it's the wrong way. So it's
really
the first two Moncton. So
which
Moncton,
really
Moncton
can hurt Moncton.
Moncton prefers to be away, and they have home ice, and if they prefer to be away.
But Moncton, being on the road for that long, especially in playoffs where games that count, those three games on the road in a row where you're sleeping in a hotel room and stuff like that, it can hurt. It's different when it comes to playoffs, right? It's not just, you're not going from one hotel to the other. You're just on the road. And the 2-3-2 series kind of negates the home ice advantage in a way.
Yeah, a bit. I got them winning 5-3. I think that's going game 7. Or 4-3.
5-3.
They're going to win 5-3 in best of 7.
4-3. 4-3.
Yeah.
It's going to game 7.
I would say 4-2. 4-2. For Chicoutimi, 4-2.
4-2.
Yeah. Definitely in game 6.
You're calling Chicoutimi to win.
Who, me?
Yeah.
Oh, you're calling Chicoutimi.
No. Yeah, 4-2.
Okay. All
so
right.
The momentum will be in that 3 games, and I believe 4-2 will be for Chicoutimi.
I can see Chicoutimi pulling it out in 7.
Okay.
Because Chicoutimi's been playing hot as of late.
So you're saying 4-3 Chicoutimi.
Yeah.
And you're saying 4-2 Chicoutimi.
I am.
Okay. I love this.
I'm 2-4-2 with 4-2. Like,
we can go woo-hoo! Back. We can go back and watch this afterwards. Eagles.
Oh, definitely. That's good. Funny.
4-2 Halley, 4-2 Chicoutimi. Let's go Cape Breton versus Oceanics.
Oh, geez.
I got Eagles in 6.
You got Eagles in 6?
Eagles in six.
So you don't think Rimouski will be on fire? They beat Quebec twice in a row.
I got
they
Eagles.
Like,
Eagles in 6. You're going 4-2 Eagles.
I'm going 4-1.
4-1?
4-1.
Eagles?
For who?
4-1. No, for Rimouski. Unfortunately, Eagles is not their years. I don't know. Rimouski got a good advance right now. They won twice against Quebec. In Quebec, they've been negligent, and they outscore Quebec quite a bit. So
yeah, but here's the thing: Quebec's down at the bottom of the league to the point they didn't even make playoffs.
So I know.
Cape Breton's also a 2-3
for a player.
To
be hot, yeah, you got a player to be hot. When they score many goals like this, now they got their aim all adjust for two games. So they could be coming out of there. But I'm going to say still 4-1 for Rimouski.
All right, I'm going to go 4-2 Rimouski.
I say Eagles have the more solid goaltending as of late. And you got Newcomb, who's really put a spark into that team since he's returned. And I think they're just going to... Not steamroll over them, but I think they're going to be more physical than them, and I think they're going to wear them down.
Okay. So let's move over to the east. We got, let's start
to the west.
It's west. Sorry, the west. The misprint screwing me up. Let's start at the bottom of the pack this time. We'll go Armada and Phoenix. Sherbrooke.
Cool.
This is an easy one for me. This is a no-brainer for me.
4-0 for Sherbrooke.
I'm going to go first. Really? I'm going to go first, and I'm going to go Armada in 6. 4-2.
I'm going Armada in 5.
In 5? Okay. Cape Breton 4-1. Cape Breton 4-2. Cape Breton 4-2. 4-3, Chicoutimi. I give it to the Eagles, Melissa says. Sherbrooke 4-2. Sherbrooke in 5, John says. 4-2 Sherbrooke. Okay. So nobody's on my side with the Armada. I think Armada's going to take it. Victoria.
You'll talk to me when you go 4-0 against our Armada.
Victoriaville and the Cataracts. Now, I don't know. I think it's going to be Victoriaville, obviously. I still don't know in how many.
I see that.
You want four? Sweet.
You want to go first, Dylan?
I just did.
Sweep, okay.
Victoriaville and four.
Sweep. I would say probably it's a Zenry sweep too, because Victoriaville's it's there.
I'm gonna give
Reese, if it's not four, then four. It's five.
I'm gonna give Reese the benefit of the doubt, and I'm gonna say 4-1. Victoriaville.
I'll get a sweep again. 4-0.
Fuck you, Tom. Collins math 5-2 Sherbrooke.
5-2.
That's
a good one. 5-2.
Yeah. Huskies.
La La Land.
Huskies and Gatineau. Go.
That's going to be a tough one. It'll be game 7.
Really?
Husky game 7. Yeah. 4-3.
Huskies and 5.
No doubt.
I see Huskies in five as well. 4-1 for Huskies, in my opinion. And then
I think Gatineau's a young team. And,
they got Russo, man. Yeah. They got Russo.
Yep.
Right?
The other brother from somewhere else.
Yeah, there's people saying 4-1 or 4-0 Huskies. Let's wait for some more to come on. Victo 4-0. Sherbrooke 5-2. Sherbrooke 4-1. Randa in 5. Gatineau will steal a game, but they don't have anywhere near the depth, John says. And Husky sweep, Trevor says.
Yep, I agree.
I still stick 4-3, but
yeah, I think that's gonna be a blowout personally. Victoriaville 4-1. Drummondville, our old coach Sly with the Sea Dogs. What do you think?
I would say 4-1 for Sea Dogs. Just surprised Victoriaville. The Drummondville.
Really?
Yeah.
That's a hope.
Or if it could go both ways. But with the St. John's, if they play their cards good, they're going to be on top of Drummondville. So they'll be 4-1. And if it goes the other way, it's going to be 4-1. So it's going to be either 4-1. I still say Drummondville 4-1.
Trevor says Dogs in 7. He thinks it's going to go the distance.
Wow.
I can see it.
John says I can see it. Drummondville in 5.
Well, do you see how much is the playoff tickets?
Oh, for St. John.
No.
St. John's. It's St. John's. $10. For general admission, and $7 for the season ticket holder.
Wow.
For any
season.
I was like, okay. But don't forget there's tax and fees with that.
That's
but
nothing. Still, wow. That's crazy.
They want to get the crowd. They want to get the crowd, and that's why if it goes to Sea Dogs, it will be 4-1 for Sea Dogs. And if it goes on the other way, it's going to be 4-1 for Drummondville. If Sea Dogs don't their thing together. That's my logic right now.
So I haven't given
Is that series a 3-2 or a 2-3-2 as well?
I don't know.
I think it's over the distance.
So a great advantage to St. John's, man.
Is that something they implemented this year?
No.
No.
Over a certain distance is always 2-3-2.
Okay.
Yeah, it is.
I don't remember.
We did that with the Quebec.
The Sherbrooke series was 2-3-2, I believe. No.
Yes.
No.
The first two rounds, it's 2-3-2. I think semifinals and
that makes sense.
Finals are 2-2, 1-1-1.
Yeah, that makes sense. All right, so I think Drummondville is going to take it, but I think it's going to take 6 to do it. I just have too much faith in Sly. 700 kilometer rule is what Trevor says. 2-3-2.
Yeah, I'm going Dogs in 7.
Dogs in 7. Wow.
I think Lamoureux being out, even though they've been playing without him for a while, I think they're really going to miss him in the playoffs.
Best case scenario for us to meet in the next two rounds.
Say that again.
Best case scenario for the next three rounds. Who do you want to play?
Well, we didn't even talk about our series yet.
Jump the gun.
I don't even want to. I'm so nervous, man. Like, I know the boys.
Jump the gun.
I know the boys can pull it out. I really do. It's just that team is so physical, man. I don't even want to play them. I really don't. I don't want to hurt any more of our boys. So let's talk.
So what do you got?
Let's talk about
what do you
T10.
Got?
For T10?
Yeah, for us.
What do I think we should do for T10? Oh, for us. Oh, that's what you're talking about.
Yeah, we haven't talked about what we think it's going to be.
I think it's going to take all seven. I think it's going to be us, but I think it's going to take all seven.
I don't know. I think it will take him five games.
You think we're... No. Trevor says five games as well, 4-1
Halifax. Trevor, six. Like, I'm debating between five games and six, but I think now they figured out what to do against against the Tita killer. So I'll say it's going to be 4-1. Moosehead.
I say
they're gonna trample him. Go ahead.
I say Moose in six.
Okay.
Yeah, some people are agreeing with you. Jose agrees with you. I think John agrees with you here. Being said, he says five, but he says I could see it going to game six. Tom says six. I think it's going to take all seven. I do.
Cool.
So best case scenario, second round, who do we face? Ideal situation, who do you want to face?
Well, I would like to see against the Eagles, but I choose Ramoski, so it'll be Ramoski and Moosehead.
I want to play Moncton.
So best case scenario, the team that we play, like if we're taking our predictions out, an absolute best case scenario is we play the Islanders.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's going to happen, but that's best case scenario. We play the lowest seeded team.
Yeah, definitely.
I don't know. I honestly don't know if we can beat the Islanders.
Because at the... If I follow this, so I would say that Shikotomi was going to win against Moncton, so it would be probably against Shikotomi and Halifax. If we look at the standing and my projection there, and Beckham will play Rimouski, which is going to be a pretty interesting game. Especially the big couple in Rimouski and Moosehead versus Shikunumi. And Moosehead's got to get a good revenge against Shikunumi. So I think it'll be a good battle for the West there.
I honestly think the best people we play against is going to be the Wildcats, the Baykomo, and the Voltigeurs. I think that's who we're going to play the best against.
Our series against Moncton has been too close that if we play them in the second round, it can go either way.
Agreed.
Best case scenario, like it'll be exciting hockey. That's best case scenario for exciting hockey. But best case scenario for like the win is the Islanders. It's the lowest placed team.
I mean, if you're going on stats alone, hopefully. I agree, but. We've had such a shit time playing these lower tier teams.
It's like we've pretty much dominated Islanders majority of the time we played. We haven't split the series with them.
It's 5-4, is it not?
With the Islanders? No.
Let me check that.
Islanders.
I thought it was 5-4. That was pretty close. I could be wrong. I typed it into the wrong thing. My bad. Disregard that comment in the chat, guys.
Oh, somebody fired in the chat?
No, I put something up. I typed in QMJHL. Oh. Just. All I can say, all I'll say, Colin, is in Halton we trust. The best games we've had against Charlottetown have been quite recently. No way the Islanders are going to beat Bay, Kamo Kim says.
Oh, I'm not saying they're going to win, but I'm saying that's best case scenario for us.
Yeah, I think that's what we're talking about. But I think that subject, if you go with your picks you had, who's going to win?
No, that wasn't the question. The question was best case scenario.
Yeah.
Oh, for second round. Okay.
When was the last game against St. John or against them again?
That's what I'm looking for.
The Islanders.
That's what I'm looking for.
It was 7-0. We destroyed them 7-0.
I just need to know the date.
Oh, the dates? So the 8th of, no, the 10th of February, that's the
February 10th. Okay.
Yeah.
That's all I needed.
Yeah. And the last one, well, the last one was the 14th of March. And the win was.
So Kim
played them on March 14th?
Yes. That's a recent.
That's
a
late.
And we won 4-2.
That's the one I want.
So Kim says, no way the Islanders are beating Bay, Kamo. And Trevor says, who's going to the Rocks this weekend? Jose says, Kim, if Charlottetown wins game one, you need to shave your head. Not a chance, Kim says. Appointment with Dr. P.
So our record against Charlottetown is 6-2-0-1.
6-2-0-1. Okay. All right. Why does it always feel like we're struggling against them then? Every time we play them, I feel like we're struggling. So we only lost the first two games against them. Preseason, like the
we lost three games against them because there was one shootout loss.
Yeah. Forget that. I'm not concerned with that. But the first two games we played them before we had any of our players are the only time we lost against them in regulation.
Yes.
Wow, my mind is scattered. I thought they were doing. I thought that was way.
Was it? Was it Bartolo in the net there?
What's for that? The first two games? I think they had both of their goalies because it was back-to-back.
And that was at the October when I was deployed.
Yeah, I don't know if Ozil was out at a
no, he was here.
Was he here?
He was here.
I mean, he was good enough to go play for the juniors, so...
It was September. Okay, it was September. The three losses, 3-1 and 6-1. Who was the bullies?
Trevor thinks the LFG LFD crew are royalty. Says all newbies at the Rock buy the LFD LFG LFD crew shots.
Nope. Yeah, Benacol in the first game, the 3-1 win, and I think Benacol was the second game too. I get who said that. All
right, so
Islanders. No, it was also. Also for the second game.
Yeah, they swapped their goalies out.
Okay, so
yeah,
I don't have much left to say. You know, I think it's pretty obvious that we have some work to put in for the first series. You guys have it. You're 5. You're 4-1. You're 4-2.
4-2.
And
I have
4-3.
It 6.
All right. So we're all saying that we win, but we're all saying a different amount of games. Okay.
It also depends on who is healthy for those games too.
Yeah.
That's a big factor. Like, let's say,
let's talk
about if Dumay is healthy and able to play game two, which I'll be honest, I don't see happening. I don't see him being ready until second round at the absolute soonest, but if he's ready by game two, that could be a game changer.
Yeah. Everybody knows about this surgery, so that's the disadvantage for our team with Dumay, because they're gonna get to him,
right? Yeah, but they won't know the state that he's at.
That is true, but if you look at like anywhere to go to playoff, injuries happen all the time, and they hide their injuries, so the other team doesn't go out against that injury, right?
It actually happened to Dumay last year.
Oh yeah, did you?
Huh?
Wow. What'd you get? What injury?
What?
the last year.
I said it happened May last year. Where they he played injured.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's always one or two players that are really beat up and they still keep going. Ooh. And kudos for them to get the keep going with that. Right?
Joanne's comment.
Uh-oh.
Batherson 6. Joanne, Tyler would be screaming at you right now. Wow. Batherson 6.
She stayed on my 4-2 everywhere. She stayed on my 4-2.
If she's been watching this whole time, she's been sitting there saying, should I comment this? I don't know if I'm going to say it. Am I going to say it? I'm going to say it.
No, she didn't even think twice about it. As soon as she typed it right away.
Wow, that's incredible. So we know that Furlong is hurt. It's serious. We don't know how long he's going to be out. McPhee hoping he returns for the playoffs.
He is regular jersey in practice as of today.
And Mike.
That is confirmed. So it's looking more and more likely that McPhee will be playing game one.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see Dumais in, whether he is or not. I'm not sure. And then we got Lou and Morvec who were out sick last time. They should return. I didn't hear anything bad about them, and you know, they were probably just sick, so hopefully they return. I'm telling you, they have our number, Joanne says. Howdy, that's a great series.
They maybe get their number, but I mean,
you know what, Joanne? If we win, I'm walking up to the boys and I'm telling them all that Joanne had you guys losing in 6.
See what they say. Psychology.
I'm just joking. I won't do it. All right, guys. Look, I'm done. I'm gonna cut this. We're an hour and 20 minutes now, and I'm drained. I've been drained since about 20 minutes into this thing. So, I look forward to the
8675309. Look, read the comments.
What is that for?
Is that taxi, casino taxi or something?
No, that's not casino taxi.
No, 4-5-6.
It's a jingle, six, though. What is it a jingle for?
It's a song. It's an actual song.
Oh, it's an actual song. Okay. What about the bus? Okay, all right. Okay, Tom. All right, Tom.
Talk about the bus.
You guys haven't given me anything to talk about in the chat other than your guys' own inside jokes. I wasn't on the bus trip. If you want something to talk about, put it down. Let us know what happened.
Did you guys play bingo?
Joanne told the boys today that they're going down in 6. Fucking Joanne.
Oh, pizza.
It's a classic song from the 80s. Tell us something that happened that's cool on the bus trip then, Tom. Jesus. Trevor, let us know what happened. I wasn't there. I'm talking to the chat like they can hear me and see me instead of looking into here.
Well, I'm looking in the chat right now, so we'll see if it's going there.
Is Steve teleporting? No, he just leans back too far, and Hal takes over. Well, went to church Saturday morning. It was liberating. That's awesome. I'm glad. That's really cool. I'm surprised you didn't burst into flames there, Trevor, but good, man. You told us we would talk about it at the end of the chat, but I also asked you to put it in the chat so I can refer to it and put it into the show. I don't know what happened. Come on, Tom.
I know what happened. I know what happened.
What?
There were people on a bus. They all met up and split. They got on the bus and the bus started to drive. And then they pulled out these cardboard bingo things.
Kevin won 6 or 7 times in bingo.
Nice.
How many
cribs? Wow. How many crib boards? I won 2, for fuck's sakes. Tyler
was twerking
on the bus.
Colin, you won 1, and CJ won 1.
That's right. One broken foot. Who had a broken foot? What the hell did we miss?
What?
Oh, I think that was Kayla.
Somebody had a broken
foot. Kayla said she broke her foot.
Tyler was twerking on the bus. There was lots of Jell-O.
Yeah, lots of Jell-O.
Lots of Jell-O.
That's crazy. Good times, man.
There was some really cool gifts,
winnings, whatever they call them.
What were some of the prizes?
Yeah, what were some of the prizes? Benji said Tyler isn't allowed to sit behind the bench anymore at games.
I can recall that. It was hilarious. I was keep telling Tyler a bunch of stuff, and he was like, stop it, you're annoying. I was like, I'm just doing my thing, man. I'm just having fun. And you know what? We'll have the W today. We'll have the W, and we did have the W.
Somebody said,
and I told him, well, they're presenting Brody in there. I told him he's gonna score tonight. Don't worry. Okay. And when he scored, he booed him. I was like, what are you doing, Tyler? He scored. Brody scored. I don't care. I want the W. Okay. Also, time French too. That was hilarious. But he enjoyed his ice cream. He enjoyed the game. He was passionate about it. So it was awesome to be beside Tyler.
Tyler's
and
fun.
I think always behind the bench of the Moosehead. It was great. Jake Todd like was giving the good smile and all stuff. Dylan was like winking, giving a fist bump. Man, it was great to be beside Tyler. I was like, man.
He also gave Joanne really the finger.
Who gave Joanne the finger?
McKinnon.
Awesome.
Because Joanne yelled to him, nice goal, you bum. So he scratched his nose with his middle finger.
That's awesome.
That's
she was saying that she was saying the coaches were really confused.
At one point
when somebody in the corner there, I'm trying to remember who said that, but he called Melasson a bum too. That was he had to smile a little side and I was like, geez. Man.
Why are people calling Bob? Jesus, fuck. I love the relationship that Joanne has with these kids that they feel comfortable enough to flip her off. I love that, man. I love that. That's wicked. I'm so happy.
While on the bench during a game.
Well, yeah, right. Joey left a skid mark on the bus at the bus stop window.
What?
What? Okay.
Wow.
Okay. I heard her on my side. Tyler was too loud. Ron told a bad.
There's no such thing as Tyler being too loud.
No.
I got him louder than that second game.
So, is there any plans for a bus trip, for playoffs? Like, is that something that we can throw together?
Well, you'd have to know who we're playing first,
I know that.
So. I think the issue with doing a bus trip for that, it would be easier if the Mooseheads were to do it the way that they did it last year, because it's too hard for us to know. If our series goes 7, and if we play Moncton in the second round, the next game could be like 3 days later or 4 days later. It's too hard to book a bus, get people into it, and stuff like that, right? So I think it would be too hard for plans to... or for fans to put together, but the Mooseheads, it would be a little bit easier because they could possibly put, like, they have a better idea of when games would land.
Yeah.
Like, for the future, depending on who we play.
And get a section, like, basically get a section for the away team and...
Well, no, not just that. It's more so the bus, right? To get a bus and to get people to organize and pay for it that quick is... really difficult, especially with fans doing it, because you would have to get the bus full. I'm sure it'd be easy to get the bus full, but how many people can come up with $80 to $100, depending on what the tickets are, when it could be for, like, so today's Tuesday. All right, game 7 just ended, or Moncton's game 7 just ended. We're playing, and... we're playing up there on Thursday. We need all of your money by tonight.
Yeah, that's
for instance,
crazy.
Right? Definitely. Right? It's hard to figure things out because you got to make sure that the buses are available.
And that's
the only thing they could probably do. It's a deposit for like one quarter of it and get back your deposit if it doesn't happen. So they could happen to do that. Like I could probably see that, the deposit a little bit and go and pay the full after. Like, I don't know if it would be possible.
But you would still have to. Give the dates for the team, like for the day that you would need the bus, right? And right now we only know the dates for the first rounds.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like for each round, like kind of have a deposit. If you would like to join to those games against the other team, it's just get a deposit right in advance. And if they don't play those games, well, they can get back the money there. So it's kind of like secure and help out to not pay a full amount of $80 or $100 right off the bat for two games or three games, right?
Oh, Trevor just said they're not planning a road trip.
Yeah, he also said that if Roxbury gets word that they will show up, they will put the game on. So they essentially will host a watch party.
That's if East Link is hosting it, is playing it.
Yeah, Roxbury has East Link, he says, Which, I mean, it's playoffs, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but they cover more than just one team.
Anybody under 19 has to leave by 9. Wah, wah.
Yeah, and don't forget, if anybody in the Moose Country there wants the playoff, you got to pay for the playoff, and it's just suddenly amount. It's like the season, it's just a playoff for all the games.
No, you have to buy it per round. It's $20 per round.
Is it per game?
Per round.
Is it per season game ticket? Second ticket holders, it's per game. That's confirmed.
We're talking about CHL.
Oh, the CHL.
Yeah, it's per round.
Yeah, CHL. Yeah.
Can buy the full package.
Go check.
Yeah, definitely.
Last time I checked last year, you couldn't. It was you had to buy round by round. Otherwise, how can they refund you your money if your team doesn't make it or if you don't watch it or whatever? You can also buy per game for $9.99. So CHL. One thing I want to mention real quick, it's something I've been trying to get into one of these lives, and then we're gonna end it. Is we found a heavenly place to buy bagels. Absolutely heavenly. Okay, and this isn't an ad, there's no sponsor attached. But the place is called Bag Girls. And the reason I am bringing this up is because the owner of Bag Girls is Luke McPhee's girlfriend. So she's a local here in Cole Harbor. She goes to the same school as Savannah. She has bagels that you wouldn't have even thought of, like carrot cake and mini egg bagels. And the cool thing about this young lady is she's starting her own business as an entrepreneur, and she donates bagels to schools for the breakfast program. Like, how cool is that? At age 18, 19, 17, to, you know, have the awareness of our economic crisis to donate bagels from your own company, your own profits to the school. Yeah. I think it's absolutely
wicked.
Yeah. So I'm going to show you guys. Hold on one second. I'm going to show you guys on Facebook what her page is. So anybody wants to go buy bagels from her, shoot her a message and let them know the Moose fans sent you. And I guarantee you won't regret it. These are the most delicious bagels you'll ever eat. So this is her here, Bag Girls GD. You can see my wife's on her Facebook. A bunch of our friends are as well. But her food is absolutely delicious. Oh, look, there's Luke McPhee in the background right there. So go support her. She's local. She's young. She's trying to make a name for herself, building her own company. I think that's amazing. Please go support her. That's it for me. You want to say something, Dylan?
Yeah, I want to confirm that you can buy the full QMJHL playoff pass, or you can buy the entire CHL playoff pass. The CHL pass is $60, or $59.99, tax added at checkout. And the entire CHL, which means you can watch the WHL and everything, is $89.99 with taxes added at the checkout.
That's crazy, because last year for the second round, we went to buy the bundle, and it made us pay $19.99 every separate. It wouldn't let us buy the package last round.
I think you have to do it before the playoffs start.
Oh, maybe.
Oh.
Because then once it gets into the playoffs, they can't charge $59.99 from the second round on, because you're not getting the full playoffs.
Possibly. Like I said, I was only going by my experience last year. It wouldn't let us last year.
You want to and with the QMJHL pass, you can watch any QMJHL playoff game.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's
the beauty of it.
This book you can still buy. You can still find it. Apparently, he's in the works of making another one. You can still buy it at local chapters, so on and so forth. You can find it on Amazon. There's a cute little bookstore / coffee shop on Strawberry Hill that you can find this book at. It's Ian Robinson's book, The Ultimate Hockey Joke Book.
Oh, you not see it? Okay, well, I was about to show the little picture. Do you want me to go with the one joke of his?
Yeah.
Okay. You know, hockey players are like goldfish. The real way to get their attention is to tap on the glass.
Unless you're in St. John, right?
Unless you're in St. John's and you got Sebastian try to hit the glass and like, and the usher's like, hey, I'm going to kick you out if you do it again.
That was Moncton last year.
Oh, it was Moncton.
Oh, Moncton. Moncton. But even St. John's, they advise us, you're not allowed to touch the glass. And they did. And they said, don't bang on the glass, please. And I was like, yeah, no problem.
LFG LFD said that a CHL VAP's not working anymore.
You got booted.
Oh,
we use we've been using the app from Rye Guy. We had Jose's app that we were using for his he was kind enough to give us his password, but we've been using the box
with Ryan's.
Yeah, it seems to work okay. Some days are better than others, but it works. St. John's on this road trip. St. John on this.
I'd want to like with the CHL app. When I was overseas, I could watch the Moosehead at the same time my wife was watching. So it was great. They don't do a restriction like Netflix or anything like that. And that's the beauty of it. You just type your password in the same in there. And you know what? It's a great thing to not be restricted for the CHL app there. So it's worth the money. Yeah. I mean, you buy words restriction and just try to share it the most you can, and at least to watch and be a fan.
Yeah, yeah. All right, guys, that's it for me. I'm drained.
Yeah, I'm out.
Hope you're all healthy, safe, and happy out there. And as always, go Moose, go.
Go Moose, go.